Hey, welcome back to GR. We are now already in the third week and we are in the middle, maybe not exactly in the middle, but maybe more the first half of the part on differential geometry. We haven't actually introduced differentials so far. We have started with just a much smaller or much more reduced structure, but we will sequentially build up the structure that we will need in order to describe space-time. So first, before starting, let me say that I really liked where you asked questions last time. I really appreciate the questions that many of you ask. It gives me a feeling of how I can proceed and where the problems lie. So please continue asking questions, interrupting me whenever necessary. Okay, I would like to start with a picture to remind ourselves where we were and also as a preparation to somehow continue. So we were talking about topological manifolds, and the way you should think of topological manifolds is that there is some structure, for example, a sphere. That's one particular example of a two-dimensional topological manifold. So a sphere, it's hard to actually draw a sphere on two dimensions, but of course you know how a sphere looks like. So that's the sphere. And what we have done to characterize it is we have somehow charted it. So we said that we can cut out regions of this sphere, for example here, a green region, or also another region, maybe here a blue one. And then for any such region, which is an open set of the entire manifold, I will always call the manifold M, we will have maps into a RD space. And in this case of a sphere, of a two sphere, it would be R2. And then we have coordinates, for example, x0 and x1, if we are in the two-dimensional case. And the point is that each of these maps generates a chart or gives us a chart of a part of this manifold. So I call this, let's say, blue chart X, and then maybe the green one Y. And of course, the green one maps into another R2 space. Maybe I call it here actually maybe Y, the map. So the coordinate maps would be Y0 and Y1. And then I also get an image of this green region. By the way, the image doesn't need to look the same as on the left-hand side, because that's just an arbitrary map that somehow represents a part of the manifold. So what I've drawn on the right-hand side is in a way the image of XU and the image X of U and the image Y of V. So let's call this green region V and the blue one U. We have also at the very end said that these regions may overlap. So there's this overlapping part, which I could call U intersected with V. And of course this, okay, that would be wrong. The intersection, of course, is also mapped within that region. So that's X of U intersected with V. And of course, it has also an image under the Y map. So this would be Y of U intersected with V. And then we said that if we have two such maps, we could, of course, also directly go from one representation, from one chart to the other. And this would just be the concatenation of the inverse of the chart map X concatenated with the chart map Y. So this concatenation, I usually write with a little circle. That's just a concatenation of functions. Remember that the only or almost the only requirement to these chart maps X and Y was that they are homeomorphisms. Homeomorphisms are maps which are invertible. I mean, of course, they are not invertible on the whole R2. They are just invertible on the image of U, so on this blue region on the right-hand side. And both the map and the inverse of the map should be continuous. And you know that continuity has now a more general meaning for arbitrary topological spaces. On the left-hand side, we have an arbitrary topology that has, I mean, and the only requirement to that topology is exactly that such a continuous map exists into RD for a D-dimensional topological manifold. And on the right-hand side, we have something we already understand. That's just RD equipped with the standard topology. I think this is essentially where we were. And this is very little structure. So in particular, we have not any notion of kind of linearity. I mean, usually the Euclidean space is equipped with a vector space structure, but this has no meaning on the left-hand side so far. Of course, today we will actually go further and equip the left-hand side with more structure, in particular some linear structure. But it will not be a linear structure on the whole manifold. It will, in a way, capture the fact that, again, locally the manifold is linear. Already the characterization we have so far is a local characterization. We are essentially saying the manifold, the sphere, looks locally like R2. It has these two dimensions. Now, if you were just interested in describing the two sphere, for example, there would have been a seemingly much simpler way to do that. We could just say, let's start with R3 and then embed the sphere, the S2, in R3. That's usually how we think of a real sphere. The real sphere lives in three-dimensional space, and then, of course, it defines a two-dimensional surface in that three-dimensional space. However, the way we defined it here never talks about the three-dimensional space in which the sphere is embedded. Of course, you can think of the three-dimensional space when you think of the object here on the left-hand side, but in the mathematical definition, we never talked about R3. And that will actually be something we will always do in the following. In particular, of course, we will not talk about two-dimensional spheres, but about the four-dimensional space-time. And this four-dimensional space-time will essentially play the role of what is the two-dimensional sphere here. So it will itself, like the sphere, I mean, we haven't introduced that mathematically, but the sphere is of course curved, and the four-dimensional space-time will be curved, as you know. That's the main part of general relativity that we will see and introduce in detail. But it would be quite hard to see this four-dimensional space-time in the same way as a sphere living in a larger dimensional space embedded in a larger dimensional thing. We wouldn't even know what that thing should be. So the alternative would really be to somehow define an even higher dimensional space within which the four-dimensional space-time is kind of like a surface. I mean, a surface, by that I now mean a lower dimensional space. That could in principle be done mathematically, and indeed it has been shown that topological manifolds can actually always be embedded into Euclidean space under certain maybe weak conditions, but essentially can always think in that way if you like. But this higher dimensional space within which you would embed space-time has no physical meaning. There's not such a thing like a higher dimensional thing in which our space-time lives, at least you don't know of it. And that's why it's much safer to somehow just work in this four-dimensional space-time and not introduce higher dimensions that don't have a physical meaning. Because whenever we add structure, like the outer space, this outer view that isn't there, I mean, this higher dimensional thing, we add something that is only there mathematically but not physically, and then we are bound to make mistakes because we may now associate properties to that imaginary thing that doesn't really exist, and that would obviously not lead to the right answers, or most likely not lead to the right answers. So you should really think of it as if you were kind of a little bug on the surface of Earth. You wouldn't know about the third dimension. You could just move in two dimensions and then ask yourself, how would that bug describe the Earth surface in a way which doesn't need him to introduce the third dimension, but still correctly describe it, correctly capture the topology, the fact, for example, that if you go around the Earth, you arrive at the same point. And that's exactly done with this type of structure. Okay, so that was again a kind of motivation part. Now we move back to some mathematics that we need to introduce. And the first thing I should mention is just essentially terminology. But when we talk about the curve on N, on the manifold, what we will typically mean is just a function from the reals to the manifold, which is continuous. And again, when I talk about continuity and one of the spaces is R or RD, I mean R just equipped with the standard topology. And now this definition is actually equivalent to say that the so-called chart representation of the function of this curve is also continuous. So what do I mean by that? So let's just draw such a curve. So a curve takes the reals and maps it to some, let me maybe make a bit of space here. I'll just erase this chart transition map for the moment. So let's now suppose we have a curve. Now I can use the orange color for the curve. So this is something here on the manifold, this orange thing. That's a map from the reals to the manifold. And now I can, of course, ask myself, how does this curve look like on the chart? And of course, it will have a representation on the chart. By the way, if in the real manifold it cuts with the red region, it also has to do that in the chart. And of course, it also has a representation maybe in the other chart. Somehow. Maybe that's another representation of the curve, or that's a representation in the other chart. Formally, the representation of the curve in a chart is just the chart map concatenated with the function. So that's now no longer a mapping from R to M, but a mapping from R to RD. And that's something we understand much better. So it's maybe if I draw here R, so to speak, then the curve map is this function here, gamma, but now we concatenate it with the blue function indicated here and get this map from R to here, to RD. And now that because the chart maps are continuous and because their inverses are continuous, it is now of course true that the function gamma is continuous if and only if X concatenated with gamma is continuous. So these two statements are equivalent. Okay, that's almost trivial, but let's say the key point here is to say that we can generally, and we will do that in the future quite often, define an object either purely here on the manifold, or we can define it via the chart representation. So in both cases, we are really defining the same thing. So I define here in a way what it means for a curve to be continuous. I can do it directly here, that's this definition, or I can talk about the chart representation, that's this definition. Later we will have cases where we will no longer immediately have an obvious definition here on the left hand side. So we will have to go via the chart representation and define it there. And that's a bit more dangerous because when we define something on the right-hand side, it could always be that the definition depends on the choice of the chart map. So a priori, we have to ask ourselves, if it just started with this definition, we have to ask ourselves whether defining continuity according to the chart map X is the same thing as defining continuity with respect to the chart map Y. And if this was not the case, then this would not be a well-defined thing on the manifold, because it would depend on our choice of the chart map. But we want actually things to be defined independently at the end of the chart map, because like an atlas, the atlas is something we make up that's not part of the real Earth surface. So if a definition of something with a physical meaning would depend on the atlas that we are choosing or the charts by which we are representing these things, then this is obviously not a physically relevant definition. So to say it maybe even more plainly, if we look at the trajectory of an object, of a real object in space-time, and if we now have a definition or some statement about this trajectory, or some physical law that would depend, that would be formulated here on the chart and therefore depend on X, then it necessarily must be the case that it should have the same property on Y, because otherwise the property, the trajectory of the object here would depend on the choice of a chart. And obviously this object that is flying around in the real world doesn't care about which chart we are using. So this would not be a good physical description of what's happening. So I'm stressing this point because we will have to come back to that very often, because we will very often make definitions here and have to check exactly that point. Okay, so as I said, we have very little structure, and the whole point of starting with little structure is not to introduce anything that is not physically justified. But I told you last time that we will introduce a few things just for convenience. And this convenience allows us to use mathematical tools. And actually, maybe a good example, which I want to come back to, and this is related to a question that was asked last time, was about additional properties. And one of these additional properties that topological spaces can have is the so-called Hausdorff property. I think there was a question about, should the manifold be Hausdorff? And here there is kind of a mathematics answer and a physics answer. So I actually looked up how this thing is defined in the differential geometry lecture of last year. And it's clear there, and just to be sure that there is not at the end a conflict, for that to be compatible with that, I should really add to my definition that the space, that the M should also be Hausdorff. So in mathematics, if you talk about an d-dimensional topological manifold, you have exactly the requirement I had plus, I mean, the requirement I had was that there exists these chart maps into RD plus the requirement that M is Hausdorff. Now, by the way, just for the terminology, and I adapted that in the script to be compatible, if we drop the Hausdorff property, then it's just called a local Euclidean space. So now, for those who are maybe not familiar with what Hausdorff property actually means, it just means the following. If you are on the manifold and take two different points on the manifold, then it should be true that there should be a neighborhood of the one point and a neighborhood of the other point, so that these neighborhoods don't overlap. This is obviously true for our standard notion of topology in RD, and that's why I said last time, it's clear that this will hold locally. And now my physics answer to that is, indeed, the local thing is the only thing we can actually physically verify. We can just say we can test the world locally and see that it has this property. And if for some reason the manifold at the end, let's say, here the global property is such that this Hausdorff axiom is not satisfied, then it's not clear what that would physically mean. However, maybe to illustrate this a bit better, I could even add that it's actually possible to come up with a physical theory in which things work as usual, like the physical experiments have the same outcomes as the one we are usually used to. But nevertheless, the actual space-time doesn't have this Hausdorff property. And okay, this goes a bit far, but let me just spend 2 minutes on that, because it may be of interest to those who already know a bit more about quantum mechanics. So in quantum mechanics, I mean, I told you that quantum mechanics is not compatible with GR. Nevertheless, you can ask yourself, what does it mean to embed quantum mechanical things into space-time, and space-time still has, of course, even in quantum mechanics, locally this Euclidean structure. But in quantum mechanics, we have additional problems like the measurement problem. I don't know whether you have heard of that, but essentially it's a problem that a measurement can have random outcomes, and it's not clear what that actually means on the global level. So it could be that if you have a measurement with two outcomes that are equally likely, like you have a spin particle that is in a superposition of being up and down, and you measure in the up-down directions, then quantum mechanics tells you you get with probability so-and-so up and with probability so-and-so down. However, there is an interpretation of quantum mechanics which tells you that actually both things occur. This is called the many worlds theory, which would just assert that somehow the world splits into two worlds, in one of which you see the spin up and in the other you see the spin down. If I would now draw kind of the space-time diagram of that, and only, actually, let me only draw the time axis, this would be t or x0, as I often call it, then we would have a world line of the particle which goes up and then suddenly splits into two different parts. Now, this is just the time picture. In principle, we would need to add three spatial dimensions, but you see you have somehow a discontinuity, if you like. And if I look at this more precisely, I could maybe draw this instead of the way I did it now in the following way. I could say before the measurement, the particle had just had one world line. And then after the measurement, there are two world lines, one here, and maybe I just draw the other somewhere else. So that's just then indicating that we have now somehow two different world lines. They're not at different locations in space. So the horizontal direction is not space. It's not clear what it is. It's just saying there is now something here and something here. Now the point is, topologically, I would need to draw this in the following way. I would need to say, actually, this from this left-hand side thing, it was also a part before the measurement. I indicate that with orange, and these parts before the measurement were equal. There was just one spin particle, and then I measured it, and the world split into this green one. Let's say in this one, the spin is up, and in the other, it's down. Now, if you look at the topology of that, it doesn't have the Hausdorff property, because indeed, if you look at an open set around this point, this would be like an open set, and you look at an open set around the blue point, then these two open sets actually overlap. It doesn't look like that, but remember that the orange part is the same. So in this region, they overlap. And however small you make this open set, they will always overlap. So this is an example. So the many worlds theory of quantum mechanics is an example of a global topology where you don't have the Hausdorff property. And it's not a falsified theory. It's a very strange theory, if you think about it, but it's not a falsified one. So that's why the Hausdorff property is a nice example of a property that mathematically is very convenient to introduce, also because it allows us to make a lot of extremely elegant structural statements about manifolds, which we couldn't make without that, but which we cannot, at least not in a way I know, justify physically. Nevertheless, it's reasonable to assume, I mean, to somehow introduce the assumption, because we can still, as long as we keep track of the fact that we made this assumption, and if we have questions where it could be relevant to not have made it, we need to come back and not say by an axiom, okay, that's just there. So we need to have this this distinction always in mind about which assumptions did we introduce for physical reasons and which ones just for convenience. Now the next structure, okay, that's all about this, let's say, topological aspect. I would now move on to a next level of introducing structure, which is somehow motivated physically, and I will tell you how, but it also has a kind of convenience aspect in it. And I will, of course, make that more precise in a minute. But this will end this part, let's say this section 3.2, 3.1, and we will continue with 3.2, which is also a good point to ask questions. So if anything was unclear up to now, please ask now. Okay, don't see any questions. And let me therefore continue with that chapter. Of course, you can, as usual, always interrupt. So I start with a definition. And then I will, of course, illustrate that. But let's just talk about the actual mathematical part. A differentiable manifold. So that's the main object we will talk about in the future. This is now something that has more structure. So remember, we had already said, first of all, space-time is a set, the set of events. So that was no structure. It's just a mesh of things. It's not even, it would be as if you cut space-time into individual points and put them all in a bag and shake it. So it has no notion of closeness. But then we added the topology. So we said it should locally have the topology of Euclidean space. That gives a lot of more information about how space-time is. And now we are adding even more structure, which I call A for Atlas. So what is that? So a differentiable manifold is such a thing with this additional structure. So it is, first of all, a topological manifold. So everything we said so far, and let us now include the Hausdorff property, is in that. But it's equipped with an atlas, a particular atlas. So remember, an atlas generally is something we already defined in the context of topological manifolds. We said that if you have enough charts so that the whole manifold is covered, like if we cover the whole Earth surface with maps, then we have a whole atlas. Now, what we do here is that we single out one particular atlas and say this is a special atlas, and it has to have a particular property, namely its chart transition maps are all differentiable functions. So that's the additional requirement. So remember that the chart transition maps are the maps from RD to RD. Now, so far in a topological manifold, it's not clear that this is differentiable. It just has to be continuous. But a function that is continuous is obviously not necessarily differentiable. Now we are saying, let's just specify an atlas in which we have this differentiable property in the chart transition. Sorry, now remember what I said before. I said before that we would like to define things on the left-hand side, but now I didn't do it. I actually defined the differentiable structure via the chart maps. And that will cause a lot of work because we will now, for any notion that we introduce, have to make sure it's still well defined on the left-hand side. But that's just something we have to do because on the left-hand side, there is a priori no notion of differentiability. The reason is that the notion of differentiability is something we already know what it means on RD. So maybe I should even stress that point here in the definition. They're all differentiable functions of the form RD to RD. And of course, what a differentiable function means is something you learned in analysis. Now I should maybe say, is it only once differentiable or is there a second differential? I will come back to that, but at least this is a notion that is known because it's in RD. But if I told you, I have here a differentiable function from an arbitrary topological space M to something, to R, then it wouldn't be clear what differentiable means because Note that even to define a differential, you do some non-trivial operations. You take two points that are close, you take the difference between the two points, then you divide by something, by somehow the difference, and you take a limus of that. All these operations would need to be defined, and they are defined on RD, because in RD we obviously have a subtraction, we have a division, and so on. But they wouldn't be defined on M. So in order to define this notion of differentiability, it's necessary to go to these Euclidean spaces where we have already more structure, where we have some, let's say, where we have the prerequisites to define differentiability. Okay, now what do I mean by differentiable? Here comes now the, so first of all, the fact, so this whole thing that there should be something like differentiability has a physical reason. What it actually means physically is the following. Later we will look at many, I mean, or you know that already now, that from the exercises probably, that a curve as I drew it here, I mean, here I had the two sphere, but if you think of this here as the as space-time, then a curve will correspond to a trajectory, for example, of a particle or the world line of light. I mean, it doesn't need to be a massive particle, but it's a trajectory typically. And now the fact that we can take differentials will mean that these trajectories, I mean, okay, translated now to the trajectories means that the trajectories at any point have a well-defined direction. So to see that, maybe it's good to just think of the opposite. Think of a trajectory which somehow is not differentiable, so it goes up and suddenly has a kink and it goes to the right, or a kind of a sharp corner, so something up and then right. Then at that point, it's not differentiable. So this trajectory here is not differentiable at this point. And that's what we want to avoid. So physically, the assumption that we have a differentiable manifold has to do with the fact that we want to be able to define trajectories in such a way that at any point they have a well-defined direction. Of course, we can then still go to, I mean, we can still mathematically then introduce trajectories which don't have that, but it allows us to model the fact that the trajectory has at any point a well-defined direction. So that's the physical part of this assumption. That's a reasonable assumption, you could say. I mean, we can somehow determine the direction of a particle at any point in time. Now the question is, does it have to be C1 or C2 or C infinity differentiable? Here comes maybe more the convenience part, which would be hard to justify physically. I mean, why should it be, for example, for physical reason, be 7 times differentiable and not 8 times? But it's just convenient to assume that it's infinitely often differentiable. Luckily, this is not a pure convenience assumption. There are theorems which tell us that if a manifold admits such a differential structure, it has such an atlas, then which is C1, which is once differentiable continuously, then there is necessarily another atlas, or okay, maybe before I say that, let me introduce a notion of a maximum atlas, and I can express this more elegantly. So if I give you an atlas, you can always extend it to a maximum atlas. What it means is that you just think of you have the atlas, which is like a book with the charts. Now you add pages to the book. Then you add every other possible chart which still satisfies the criterion. Here the criterion is that the chart transition map is differentiable. So of course there are infinitely many, just even uncountably many charts you could add which are somehow have a differentiable chart transition map to any of the already existing charts in the atlas. But mathematically we can think of that, and you can somehow think of a maximum atlas which just includes all these charts. And that's somehow just a useful notion. Of course, in practice you wouldn't buy such an atlas, but for our treatment it's useful to always think of the atlas to be maximum. Now the statement that I wanted to make maybe can be phrased like that. If we have a differentiable manifold with a maximum atlas, eh? So we extend it to a maximum atlas, which is C1. Then there is always a sub-atlas, so you throw away a few charts, but even when you have thrown them away, what remains is still a full atlas with charts whose chart transition function is infinitely often differentiable. And this somehow justifies that it's, let's say, from the physical justification that it should be once differentiable, we get by this mathematical theorem immediately a reason why we could just as well, equally well, assume it's infinitely often differentiable, just reduce to that atlas, and then work with that. So this is all to say that in the following, we will always assume that all these objects are infinitely often differentiable, except if I make an explicit counterexample to something. So this will always be our implicit assumption. I mean, implicit, it's, I now made it explicit, but I will not repeat it all the time.
Sorry, can I ask a question quickly?
Yes, of course, please.
In your definition, you said if a manifold is differentiable and has has maximum atlas, mm-hmm. then if it's C1 differentiable on some atlas, then it's infinitely, but why do you say only on some atlas? Why it's not infinitely differentiable on maximum? Uh-huh.
Okay, that's a very good question. Let me maybe before answering it, say one more thing which may help understand or putting that in context. So let's suppose I just give you a topological manifold. So I only give you these two things, M and O. So I give you the set and I give you the topological structure, like a sphere. Then you could, and I could ask myself, is it clear that there always exists actually such an atlas which has all chart transitions functions as differentiable functions? So that's not even clear whether it exists if you start with a sphere. Now for a sphere, of course, we know it exists because we could even construct it. I mean, I just take different charts that actually correspond to the charts we have in real atlases. These are really the representations of things. But then the other question is it unique? Because someone could come up with an atlas now for the sphere and someone else could come up with another atlas for the sphere. And it could now, let's say, the two persons, in quantum information, we always call them Alice and Bob. Let's say Alice has an atlas and Bob has an atlas. They both individually satisfy this definition that their chart transition functions or maps are differentiable. Now they could try to put their atlas together. So they would have now a bigger atlas, the Alice and Bob joint atlas. And the question is now this new atlas still satisfying this criterion that all chart transition maps are differentiable? And this is not necessarily the case because they just checked within Alice's atlas that this is the case and within Bob's separately, but it's not clear that if you go from Alice to Bob's atlas, it's a differentiable function. And mathematicians have studied this question quite intensively there because if it was the case that generally, there would not exist differentiable function to go from one atlas to the other. This would mean that there could be two different topological structures that you give, that you give a given fixed topological object like a sphere two different differential structures. So it could even be that they are then not diffeomorphic. I will just tell you in a minute what that means. And indeed, actually, this sounds like a very obvious question. Is there even a unique differentiable atlas? And this question is not answered so far. So there are open questions, for example, in the case of for a four sphere. So if you just take the four sphere as a topological object and ask yourself, what is the differential structure? There's the obvious one, the one that just arises if we embed the four sphere into the Euclidean space and do kind of and take the differential structure that arises from there. But there could be other structures that are not equivalent to that one. And whether or not these exist is an unknown problem. So we don't even know that. Okay, that was just to give some context. Now to answer your question, I mean, that was something I anyway wanted to say. But now to answer your question, if I have now a given atlas, so first of all, it's not clear that it's equivalent to other atlases. So I start from that and add all these pages until I can no longer add more pages to the atlas. By pages, I mean charts. Now, once I have this maximum atlas, and I just required that in this maximum atlas, all the chart transition functions are C1, then there could, of course, in this big atlas now be some that are indeed only C1, but not C infinity. So some chart transition maps would not be infinitely often differentiable. But now I could say, let's just, again, make a smaller atlas by throwing out all charts which cause problems in the sense that they are not infinitely often differentiable. And by that, I get a sub-atlas. I've now just thrown away things. But now if I throw away things, it could in principle happen that I throw away so much that at the end I end up no longer with an atlas. I just have something which is not covering the whole thing. But this mathematical theorem that I mentioned tells us that if you start from a C1 atlas, extend it to a maximal one, and then again reduce it by throwing away everything that is not infinitely often differentiable, you still end up with a big enough set of charts that forms an atlas. So that's the procedure. I'm not sure this now answers the question, but that at least, you can now imagine how you would proceed to construct it. You buy an atlas and then
you do that.
Okay, thank you. Are there more questions? Okay, so then I said already a few things that actually justifying why we are now assume it's infinitely often differentiable. And now comes a bit of terminology that we just need to introduce in order to talk about things happening in space-time. And this is, once you have, let's say, some intuition for what I told you so far already, this is now quite easy to digest. So if I now take a curve gamma from R to M, then I say that this curve is differentiable. That's exactly what was the motivation. We want to talk about what it means that a curve is differentiable if its representation x gamma, that's what I call a chart representation, is differentiable. So let me say for the last time, differentiable now means C infinity. So that's now one of these dangerous definitions that are announced, because now I really define things on the right-hand side. I say the curve is differentiable if its representation is differentiable. Now, what if it's different, if its representation with one chart was differentiable, but not with the other chart? Now, in this case, it's extremely easy to see that this cannot happen, because if we have a representation in terms of one chart, let me just add this here, and I want to look at the representation with another chart, y, then of course I can write this y representation as follows. I just write it as the y concatenated with the inverse of x times x gamma. So that's the same thing. And now I see that obviously by definition, so let's assume the curve was differentiable according to the X chart. So this is the differentiable. Then this is also differentiable because this is a chart transition map. And we just defined the chart transition maps to be differentiable. That was our requirement for a differentiable manifold. So that's the reason why we need a differentiable manifold. We could have made this definition already before for a topological manifold, but it would not have been a useful definition because this argument would have failed. It could then have been differentiable with respect to one chart, but not with respect to the other. But now, because we have introduced this differentiable structure, this is no longer the case. Let me make a last definition before maybe we then move on. Maybe two definitions. Although it's already time for a break, but these are short ones. A function f from the manifold to R. So this is kind of the opposite of a curve. It goes from the manifold to R. And here the definition is just the same. Is differentiable I mean, it's not the same, but it's the same spirit. And you can probably now guess what it should be. If, and if I have a definition, the if should always be understood as if and only if. Of course, it's the if of a definition. If the representation as a chart, let me maybe put that into a new line. The representation of a chart is now doing the chart inversion first and then apply the function. So this is now a function from some open set, or it's actually a function from x of u to m. Yeah, sorry, to r. Okay, this is rd. To r is differentiable. So if that is unclear, just look at the picture again that you see here on the right-hand side. So think of a function that is defined on m. So the function goes from m to r, so it would be something like that. And now the point is, I just call this function from m to r differentiable if I look at it as a function from here to r by concatenating it here with x to the minus one is still differentiable. So instead of looking at it as a function from m, I look at it as a function from the chart target or the chart, the image of the chart domain. That's what this blue set is. And again, for the same reason as before, this is well defined because again, the chart transition function, the differentiability of that implies that if this is true for one chart, then it's true for any chart. And now finally some notation. So we call the set of all such functions C infinity n. That I introduce because we will very often talk about such functions, differentiable functions on the manifold. That will be an extremely common object. Now the last object that I will define after the break, but let me already write the title, is a diffeomorphism. And once we have this defined what that is, we can actually continue with something that is then really connecting everything we have seen so far. We have introduced vector spaces before. We then want to introduce tangent spaces to the manifold. And the tangent spaces are the mathematical way to reintroduce the linear structure that we have locally in Euclidean space. So that's was what my motivation was aiming at, that you're saying we need enough structure so that the world locally still looks like our usual world. And our usual local world has a vector space structure. I will tell you what that means. And that will be the goal of the next hour, to understand what that means mathematically and also physically. Okay, but let's now make a break until 5. And as usual, I'm happy to take questions during the break.
Can I ask a question?
Yes, of course.
So you said that in principle, we could have many smooth structures. And I read in the script that in four dimensions, there may be uncountably many. So then later on, will there be a single smooth structure which makes the most sense with the universe, so with what we are looking at, or will there be many? On and what would be the effect of choosing a different smooth structure?
Okay, that's a very good question, because indeed when we start building up things, like saying we first have just this set M, and then we add topological structure, and then the differential structure, and then we need to exactly ask ourselves this question. Now, it's actually the same. Okay, one way to answer that is you can already ask yourself, what do you do when you come from M, just the set, and ask yourself, what is the correct topological structure? Because there we also have another uniqueness. If I just give you the set RD without the topological structure, then you can ask yourself, why do we now as a topological structure use what I call the standard topology? The standard topology is the one that we usually learn in analysis. Why is that one the correct one and not another one? Because there are lots of other topological structures you could in principle impose on RD. For example, the so-called chaotic topology, where essentially everything is an open set, or okay, well, this is the opposite, where that's the discrete topological structure. Chaotic one would be where only the whole set M is the open set and the empty set. And so you have a choice there. And who tells you that what we call or happen to call standard topology is exactly the physically relevant thing? So this is really then a physics question that is answered by experiment, so to speak. So of course, you could also say the reason why we called it the standard topology was exactly that mathematics was, of course, guided by how real space behaves. I mean, our intuition to introduce RE in mathematics was probably coming from physics at the end. So this is really a physics decision. It's not something that is somehow implied by any mathematics already there at that point where we say that it has this standard topology. Because as I said, already there would be uncountably many topologies you could in principle introduce. So this is a physics thing where we just say, okay, space locally behaves like that. And for the diffeomorphism, I would just say the same. This is not something, so if we only knew that space-time was four-dimensional, let's say if we told that to an alien but not give him the differentiable structure, then this alien would not be able to conclude on purely mathematical basis how our world looks like without then being able to make physics experiments. Now, the experiments that lead to this topological or to this differential structure are essentially experiments that have to do with the fact that we see certain things move continuously. So, for example, we have the real trajectory of an object in space-time that we can experimentally determine. And we want this trajectory to be differentiable. That's kind of the physical requirement. And this imposes constraints on the differentiable structure of the manifold. Because as if you look at this definition of when is a curve differentiable, this obviously depends on the choice of the atlas, because it depends on the chart. And therefore, it depends on the choice of differentiable structure. So physically, I would go the other direction and say, I just require that what the real trajectories in the world are differentiable, and I choose the differentiable structure of the manifold, which I use to model space-time, such that they are. And this is really a physics experiment in that sense. Okay. Does this answer your question?
Yeah, thank you. Thank you very much.
Are there more questions? Of course, it's now also, you're free to ask questions also about the previous lectures or more general questions. In the break, you have really no constraint in that sense. You can always ask them, but the break is maybe particularly good opportunity to ask questions which are not maybe directly related to what we are just doing at this moment. Adrian, are there any questions in the chat that I should be aware of?
Currently, I don't see any. Okay. Answered the ones that I saw, but it cleared the chat because I was thrown out quickly.
Okay, good. Thanks. I also hope the exercises were solvable. There, of course, the TAs are also happy to answer questions, but if there's anything related to the exercises that you think is of general relevance, let me know. I would also be happy to comment on those. By the way, may I just ask, I guess there are some of you who are taking differential geometry. Who is teaching that at the moment? Does anyone attend this course?
It's Will Mary was answered in the chat.
Okay, goodness.
There's also a question on whether when the solutions will be available.
So our plan is to always put the new exercises as well as the solutions of the previous one online on Wednesdays. So it will be available tomorrow at some point. Okay, we'll then move on. So we have introduced kind of particular notions for the curve being differentiable, for a function on a manifold being differentiable, and maybe the most general way to state this or to think about such things is to just think of functions between different manifolds. Of course, you can always look at R, the real line, as a manifold. So let's suppose we have two manifolds. I will just indicate them here with M and let's say N. So these are always symbols or sketches of manifolds. Of course, they have the full structure. So I mean M with the topology and the atlas and everything. And of course, a manifold also has these chart maps. It has to have them now. So actually, maybe this is an important distinction. A topological manifold is well defined without even talking about chart maps. But this is no longer the case for differentiable manifolds. So we have necessarily chart maps. And now this is now different from the figure I've drawn before, because X and Y are now chart maps of two different manifolds. Before they were chart maps of the same, but the figure otherwise looks very similar. We have here the image of U. So U is this chart domain, and on the lower part we have the image of V, where V would be another chart domain, or the domain of the V chart. And let's suppose, the most general thing we can have is just a function between these two manifolds. So when I say most general, I mean this includes a curve. A curve is just a special case where this is R. And of course, R can also be equipped with a chart, for example, a trivial chart, which is just the identity. And a function, a real function on the curve, is correspond to the special case where this manifold N is just R. And now, of course, it's just the very same definition, and I will just, it's all given in the script, and I've explained it now in these special cases. So it's quite obvious that the requirement that phi is continuous, so we say that this, or differentiable, so I should have written differentiable, but of course then it's in particular continuous. So differentiable, if and only if this chart transition map that I will draw on the right hand side, which is given by first do the inverse of the chart, then do the phi, and then do the y. Maybe I need a bit more space here. So that's the chart. Okay, no, sorry, that's not the chart transition map. That's the chart representation of the map phi. It's not a chart transition map because it's not within the same manifold. And this Y here is a different a chart of a different manifold, but it's a chart representation of the map between two different manifolds. And now, obviously, the requirement is just that this should be differentiable. And again, for the same reason as before, this is well defined because the chart transition maps are differentiable. And if I had a different chart here, for example, in the top manifold, then I would just put that in front here and I would concatenate it therefore with another differentiable function. And so I still keep the property of it being differentiable. Okay, this was in a way just terminology. So we have the only definition we have really made, which is important at this point, is that of a differentiable manifold. We have now much more structure, and we will make heavy use of that structure. And then we have just now said, now given that structure, we can talk about differentiable curves, differentiable functions, differentiable maps between manifolds. And that's these differentiable maps between manifolds are called diffeomorphisms. And they will play a quite important role again in for physics interpretation. In particular, what we will see is that if you have a manifold that represents space-time and you have another manifold that represents space-time, and if they are diffeomorphic, then they are actually physically the same. So what that means, in other words, is that physically the exact manifold is not relevant. They are only, so differences in the physics must correspond to differences up to this diffeomorphism. So if there's a relation between the two things, if they can be mapped with a diffeomorphism, there's no physical difference. And that is a quite important thing to know. And I will remind you of that once it will actually become relevant. For the moment, it's more an announcement. But there is maybe one, before I now start with the next section, maybe I write already the title, so to see where it's going to. It's called Tangent Spaces. And actually, let me mention that I updated the lecture notes, so it could be that some of the numberings has slightly changed. I have mainly only rearranged things. I've inserted a few explanations, in particular responding to questions that came up. I think there were several questions that are now somehow answered either by footnotes in the script or even by new small parts of this, of the lecture notes. So one thing I wanted to mention here, again relating to physics, is the following. So I said before that it's important to do definitions here and not here. Now, what you will also see later, and I hope you will later remember that, is that we could, so whatever mathematical property we have here, we really should always ask ourselves whether the property is also relevant on this side. And not doing that resulted in a lot of confusion in the history of general relativity. And one particular example that we will study in very much detail is the physics of a black hole. So we will see later, and don't worry if you don't understand what I'm talking about really, but we will see that a black hole has a horizon. So this is, as we will see, a point of no return. If you cross the horizon of a black hole, there is, at least according to general relativity, maybe not according to quantum mechanics, but according to general relativity, there is no way you can ever come back. Not even light can escape that horizon. Now, if you describe this black hole mathematically, you will actually see that in a representation that is usually used in a chart, so a chart will correspond somehow to a choice of coordinates, that in typical representations that you choose to describe the black hole from the outside, there is indeed a singularity at the point where this horizon lies. So you would think this is a pretty nasty place, this horizon, because there's a singularity, so a singularity is never a good thing to be close to. But it now turns out that if you move back and ask yourself, is this really a singularity? Is there really a problem at this horizon? And you study everything here in the coordinate independent picture, you will find that at least for big black holes, and I will also tell you what that means, the horizon is actually a very well-behaved region that just looks like a very normal space as we are now here. So we wouldn't actually probably notice anything if we were on the horizon of a big black hole, at least not locally. So this singularity that was in the representation and was like causing people to think that there is really something bad happening when you hit this horizon turned out to be an actually quite, okay, I'm not sure it's a nice place to be because it's still a point of no return, but nothing happens to you if you actually cross that horizon. You will not notice it. There's no real singularity. And so this should just at the moment serve as a motivation for the fact that we now introduce all this terminology and why I'm stressing so much the point that we always need to understand things on this side and not only on that side. And we have to go through a lot of mathematics to do that, but it's exactly for that reason, to not fall into the trap that things that appear to be there are actually, we should not fall into the trap that things that appear to be there are actually there. They are not. Okay. So
I have a question about last section.
Yes, please.
So diffeomorphism means when y phi x inverse is differentiable or I didn't really understand what do you call
diffeomorphism? Sorry, yes, I should actually have said yes, that was a mistake. That's good that you asked because I didn't know. I should have said that it's in both. Okay, this is the risk when only plotting pictures. I just have to check that I did it right in the lecture notes. Because indeed I want this to be yes, okay. I also didn't write it there. Okay, so when I meant that two manifolds are diffeomorphic, or there is a diffeomorphism, is really that this should hold in both directions. So meaning what I showed in this is just that this is continuous, but there should also be a map back. Now, the reason why I did that is because I want to, let's say, talk about, okay, I mean, one thing is to talk about the diffeo, things being diffeomorphic, and there I really want them to be the same. It doesn't make sense that the spaced, I mean, if it wasn't invertible, it could be that this has a lower dimension. And of course, the statement that I made before, saying that if two things are diffeomorphic, then they are really physically the same, wouldn't make sense if it was not also invertible. So I somehow, first thing you should, maybe I should separate the two things. One is just if I look at a map here and call it differentiable, but not necessarily diffeomorphism, just differentiable, then I really mean that what is written there. If I talk about two spaces being diffeomorphic, I really want this to hold in both directions. So sorry, that was actually probably confusing before.
Okay, and also, what does it mean if they're physically the same, but also there are two different manifolds?
Yes, okay. This was maybe also unclear, so thanks for asking. So actually, when we talk about the manifolds, these manifolds are in a way still an abstract mathematical object, which doesn't, I mean, not everything that is there on the manifold, like the manifold consists of all these events of the what I called possible events, and it's not clear that, let's say, these what I define mathematically, everything that I define mathematically has a physical meaning. And the statement that diffeomorphic ones are physically different means that if we do any experiment in, let's say, this manifold M and make a statement about this experiment, let's suppose, I mean, let me be make something very concrete. Let's suppose we do an experiment where we have two particles. I take the world line of one to be this dark green here. So this would be the world line of a particle. And then suppose we have another particle. Now I run out of nice colors, but let's take this one. That's another particle trajectory. Now, to say we could say, this trajectory has a particular shape. This moves a bit to the right or so in this picture. Now, it could be that if you look at the diffeomorphic or the representation on the other diffeomorphic manifold, the thing will actually maybe look like this. It moves to the left. And here, the other thing will maybe be a straight line, for example. So now, by saying that they're physically the same means that exactly saying that this now moves to the right doesn't have a physical meaning. This is just still something we make up mathematically. Because in order to measure that it actually turns right, we would need to have another particle or a reference somewhere, a reference system, and could say, it actually moves closer to that reference. Or we could, and then we would also have to draw that reference, and then it's again a well-defined thing. But there are things which are clearly measurable. For example, the question, do these two particles hit each other? That's a question that has a physical meaning, because that's something I can really measure. I can go there and see, do the particles actually collide? Now, when I say they're physically the same, this means this thing that I can measure, whether they collide, should happen here and here. So if it collides here, if the trajectories intersect, they also have to intersect here. So in other words, there are properties like how bent this is in this drawing that are not physically relevant, and there are properties that are, for example, whether they collide. And generally the physically relevant ones are those for which there exists some experiment, this may be a simple one or a very complicated one, that then gives an actual result and tests the property. And maybe to come back to the turning right, so if I would really want to would say, oh, of course I can decide whether a particle turns right, but this would mean that I have another system, a reference, let's make this color, so this is maybe a big particle that also moves up. And now I could say, oh, the green path moves closer to this violet one, and that means it moves to the right. Now in the other chart, this could just mean that the situation looks like this, so it also gets closer, although it goes left. So if, for example, you have a physics experiment that allows you to constantly observe the distance between the two, that's an experiment you can indeed do, maybe. I mean, you need to think about how you measure distances, but you can do it. Then any statement you make about the distance here should correspond to the equal statement you make about distance here, because that's now an experiment. So we will see more examples, but I think this collision is a good example of something that is clearly physically measurable. And whether this curve looks bent a bit to the right or looks bent to the left on this thing is not something I could measure. I could only measure whether it gets closer to something else or not. But maybe to make it extreme, if you just had one particle in the whole universe, nothing else, then there is nothing you could say about this particle. There would be no physical statement about its position, because it's just somewhere, but you cannot measure its position relative to anything else. So therefore, let's say if you had a manifold which was just where this particle is somewhere, and another one which where it's somewhere else, this would be a physically equivalent situation because there's nothing else around. If this is not fully clear at this point, maybe let's come back to that once we have talked more about trajectories of particles, and we will actually make this argument more precise. It's actually related, for those who are interested in the meaning of that, it's called the hole argument. It has nothing to do with black holes that I mentioned before. It's called the hole argument, and it's something that is still today a lot discussed in also in the philosophy of physics, of what it means, what is actually physically measurable and what is not.
Thank you.
I hope this gives you enough.
Thank you.
You're welcome. So the tangent spaces, as I said, are ways to impose the linear structure. And I always talked about this linear structure, and maybe I didn't really say what that would mean, but take again the Earth surface as an example. Now, what do I mean by saying that the Earth surface doesn't have a linear structure? What I mean is something very simple. I mean that if I start from a place on Earth, let's say here is Zurich, for example, and I have friends in Vienna, so let's suppose the green dot is Vienna. And now I can, of course, draw somehow a vector between the two. I mean, a vector, you know, a vector space is the typical, let's say, mathematical mathematical object that captures linearity. So I could draw a vector between Zurich and Vienna. Now this vector makes sense. It's a kind of, I could say, okay, that's really the line, the straight line that connects the two. Of course, I would have to define whether I now mean the straight line really in three-dimensional space, or whether I mean the straightest possible line that I could have on the Earth surface or so. But let's suppose for the moment that it's actually the shortest line in R3, because obviously if I do it along the Earth, then it's already bent and the linearity will anyway be lost. So if this is just the straight line through Earth slightly that connects Zurich and Vienna, if there was a vector space structure, I should be able to, for example, multiply this vector by a factor, let's say by a factor of 10. But obviously, if I do that, I get a new vector which points to some place which is not on the Earth surface. So of course, I can somehow define that, but that's not what I want. This new place has nothing to do with the thing I actually want to model, namely the Earth surface. And remember what I said, what I told you at the beginning. We are really taking this so-called intrinsic view, in particular when we talk about space-time, so we don't want to talk things around. So maybe in a big enough surrounding space, there may be something linear, but that's not the relevant thing. We want to talk about things in this manifold. And so adding these vectors up will just move us out of the manifold. So in this sense, the sphere S2 is not linear. And no one would ever have claimed it's linear, but on the other hand, if we are, of course, here in a tiny place, like Switzerland, so we're just here enclosed in this little region, then to a very good approximation, things are linear. We can add vector. It has a well-defined meaning on within Switzerland, what it means if I take the vector pointing 10 meters to the right, and if I multiply that vector now with even a factor of 100, I'm still within Switzerland, and I can really take this as 10 times that vector, and it points to a place that exists here. So approximately, we have the linear structure. And of course, mathematically, when I talk about an approximation, I really do it in a rigid way, or in the most extreme way. I let things go to zero. So I would shrink Switzerland in this picture to an arbitrarily small country. And in this arbitrarily small country, things would be arbitrarily well approximated by linear things. So that's roughly the idea of what one wants to do. Someone wants to somehow equip things with this linear structure so that we can again say that physics, so maybe to connect it again to physics, think about the equivalence principle I told you at the very beginning of the lecture. The equivalence principle talks about experiments in a small lab. And this, what we are now doing, is the mathematical analog of that. We are defining in space, which is sufficiently small, mathematically arbitrarily small, so that we can, but still not zero, so we still have some space to move and can do experiments, but it's so small that the equivalence principle applies. And I mean, the equivalence principle, we're talking about a sufficiently small lab. So you're now essentially defining as a limit what this sufficiently small lab is, and it will correspond to that. So we will be able to, in the lab, to talk about vectors and so on, and directions and all that in the usual way. Okay. Now there's another difficulty here. When I want to introduce, I mean, you could say this is now easy in the case of a sphere, just take, I mean, there is indeed a linear, well-known linear approximation of the surface here, which is essentially the tangent space. So if you interpret this little square here as a tangent that I just put on the Earth's surface, let's say at the place where Zurich lies, then I have on this tangent a perfect linear thing which somehow approximates what is around. So I could just say, let's consider these tangent spaces. They are perfectly linear, and as long as I'm not too far away from the blue dot, the tangent space almost perfectly agrees with the sphere. There's only a small distance. So I guess if I would put here a tangent on Earth within Zurich, even at the edge of the city of Zurich, there would be a very little distance between that tangent sphere and the real Earth surface if the Earth surface was a perfect sphere. Otherwise, it's, of course, anyway, not true. But that doing that, at least on the intuitive level, would again refer to the surround, to the ambient space, to the three-dimensional space, because this tangent lies in the three-dimensional space in our imagination. But what we want to do is to define this tangent space without referring to the outer three-dimensional space. Again, the reason is because for space-time, we don't have that outer that larger space, or at least you don't want to talk about it because there's no physical meaning to it. So the challenge will be to define tangent spaces without going into this higher dimensional thing. And that at first sight will introduce a lot of complication. You will ask yourself, why are we doing things in such a complicated way? It's just a tangent space that we are defining. But this is exactly the reason. The reason is exactly that we cannot think of the surrounding space. But you can still do it. And once you have understood how this works, you will find it maybe not too unnatural to do it. Okay, the idea is the following. The idea is that we want to somehow define I mean, you could say this tangent space, and this is still a good intuition, this tangent plane, is somehow the plane that is spanned by all directions. So if you think of, like, you are in Zurich and you just can move horizontally, I mean, you cannot fly, then you could say to each possible direction you could move, you associate the vector. And now the tangent space, of course, corresponds to the span of all these vectors. Of course, I would only need two because it's a two-dimensional space, but I could even look at all of them and it's still the span of them. And that's how we define it mathematically. So what we do is we look at actually paths in which we can walk. And again, like before, I will maybe here not write everything down and you will have the full treatment in the lecture notes, but I mean, I will explain everything, but not write down everything because that will just be too cumbersome. So what we do is we look at paths on the Earth surface. And the path, as I said before, is essentially, I mean, this is a curve mathematically. So curve on M. And we can always, this is just now convenience. Of course, a curve is parameterized by this real number here. I can always choose the real number such that it's in the point where I want to put the tangent plane. So let's suppose this blue point I had before is called point P. So P is a point in the manifold. It's a place where I'm interested in the tangent. And I can now choose the parameterization such that the curve exactly for parameter zero crosses the point P. Now we define the tangent vector, and then the tangent space will just be the span of all these vectors. So I exactly do what I now said intuitively. So there's a vector V, and this vector is defined, depends on this path I'm taking. So it's depending on gamma. And I also put here as an index P, because this vector is somehow, I only look at the vector exactly. I mean, of course, if I move along a path, I may change directions, but I'm interested in the direction exactly at the point where I pass P. Okay, so that's the vector, but how do we define this vector mathematically? And this is now maybe the strange thing if you haven't seen it before. I define it as a map, and namely the following map. So the vector is now not an arrow, as you may think intuitively, it's a map. And it's actually a map from the set of all infinitely differentiable functions to R. And now I have to say what this map does. So the map does the following. It takes one of these functions, an arbitrary one, and maps it to, okay, maybe I first just write down again the notation. So of course it maps it, it takes it as an argument. So whatever comes out is called this function applied to F. And now comes the actual thing. So what is it? I need a bit more space to write what it is. What it is the derivative of the function applied to the path or after the path evaluated at the point zero. So this little thing here stands for the derivative. The whole thing, you see, this is a function. Okay, maybe I should write down what that is. And don't worry, I will tell you what, I will give you some intuition about that. But this thing here is, what is it? It's a function from R to R, because it's a concatenation of a curve to M. A curve is a function to M with a function which is from M to R. So this is from R to R. Therefore, the derivative is well defined. And it's a number, the derivative evaluated at the point zero. So the point zero is, of course, where the point is a well-defined number. So it gives a number in R. Okay, so that's the definition. And that's all you need to know on the mathematical level, but of course you should have some feeling of what this intuition does. So let me again just look at the Earth surface as an example. So if you want to define what it means to walk in a particular direction, how do you do it? So think now of the Earth surface. Think for a moment of the Earth being just a sphere without anything on it, just a completely smooth sphere without houses, without lakes or rivers. It's everywhere the same. Let's suppose, however, we have identified the point P. So we have this very perfect sphere, and we have somewhere said, here's the point P, and now you walk on this sphere. Now, how do you specify the direction in which you walk? There's nothing around. So how can you specify? There's simply no way. If you are just there, you need some reference point or something to hold on. So this is now what the function f does. So the f is somehow giving you structure on the Earth surface. So you can think of f as anything that now makes the surface of the Earth not look everywhere the same. So a naive thing could be, let's suppose we color this perfect sphere. Everywhere we have a different intensity of a color. Let's say it's just one color, red, but it's more or less intense. And now the function would just be the function which tells you how intense is the color at the particular point. Now you can say more about your direction. If you now walk, you can observe how does the intensity of the color change. And now if someone asks in which direction do you walk, you can tell him, okay, I cannot give you the coordinates because there's no reference, but at least I can tell you that the intensity of the color, if I walk one step forward, has changed by so and so much. Now, of course, this doesn't specify the thing, but let's suppose there is another color, a green one, which is differently distributed on Earth's surface. So this is another function. So you also can tell for this function how the intensity of the green color changes. And then, in the case of the two-dimensional surface, this is actually already sufficient. If for two functions which are sufficiently different, you tell someone how the color changes, this person would be able to figure out in which direction you walked. So that's the idea of this definition. So the definition, in other words, says a vector tells you about the direction, but the way it does it is by telling you, you have to tell what structure you have on Earth, which is some function, and the vector tells you how does this thing change as you walk along the path gamma. Okay, so that's now a lot of intuition. Mathematically, it's just that. If you now think of this intuition and ask yourself, what does it mean? You will arrive exactly at this thing. This is how does it change? How does any structure captured by F change as you walk along the path gamma through the point P? Okay, as I said, if you see it for the first time, it sounds strange, but please try to familiarize yourself with that. It's a key notion. It's really a key notion to have these vectors as directions in this sense. Of course, there are different ways to define them, but this is the way that is actually quite close to how we use them physically. We will see, we will have particles whose environment changes as they move along space-time, and the vector tells you how the environment changes for any possible characterization of the environment in terms of F. Okay. So please feel free to ask if that was unclear. Now the tangent space can be defined very easily once we have that. So the tangent space is now just the set spanned by these vectors. So the tangent space, which we call TPM, we will see that symbol very often. That's the tangent space 2M. So that's the tangent space 2M. We first have to say which is the manifold. At what point, at P, is the vector space of all maps V gamma P, so for all gamma. So you take arbitrary paths. I can walk here and here and there, and each of these paths defines a V, and the span of these Vs is now exactly what we call the tangent space. Okay, there is often I kind of cheat a bit. No, it's not really cheating, but I do maybe things that you have to be careful about. I said, I define the space by really giving the elements, and this definition somehow, okay, if you regard it as a definition, actually a definition of the term tangent space, so it's supposed to be a definition, has at the same time a statement in it, namely that it's indeed a vector space. Because a priori, I could just have said it's a set of all these vectors, but why is it a vector space? It's a vector space because we can add these vectors. And, we have to actually satisfy all vector space axioms. So first of all, we can also multiply it. That's maybe the easier thing. So why can we multiply such a vector? This is, by the way, described in the lecture notes in mathematical detail. Let me here just give the intuition. So the question is, if some vector V is part of this space TPM, then also, for example, 2 times V has to be part of this tangent space. Otherwise, it wouldn't be a vector space. So how can I see that if a vector V is in it, is also the vector 2 times V in it? Because what I need to show is that 2 times V is again a vector of this form, maybe for a different path. And indeed here, the intuition that I gave you before is very useful. If I say walking in this direction, let's say like that, gives a vector V, defines a path gamma, and therefore a vector V. If I walk twice as fast in this direction, this will just give you a vector V, which is twice as long. That's very easy to see from this definition, because if I walk twice as fast, this derivative will be twice as big, and therefore the whole thing, everything will be multiplied by 2. So this, and of course I can do it with any factor, so this proves that multiplying a vector with a real number again gives a valid vector. It's again a vector of this form. The thing is a little bit more complicated for addition of vectors. I somehow have to add paths. So if I say I can walk in this direction and I can walk in this direction, what does it mean to add the 2 vectors? Of course, what comes out is essentially a walk. It's correspond to a path which is somehow the average of the 2 paths. And as I said, the details of that on the lecture notes, I don't want to present the proof here. It just takes a bit too much time. But if you like, if you really insist, I will be happy to do it, but probably preferably next time, because we are already, I think 5 minutes before the end, and I'm not sure this proof would fit in 5 minutes. Okay, but so for the moment, believe me that it's a vector space. So we have therefore defined this tangent space. Now, we will, this is again notation, in the future, not call these things V gamma. So this gamma, this path was just there to define things. In the future, we'll just write things like let X be an element of TPM. But the understanding is, of course, that because it's an element of TPM, there is in principle a path gamma which corresponds to the direction indicated by this vector X. Now, the special thing is that the vectors formally are maps. As I said, I mean, they're defined like that. Or you can see it here on the right-hand side. It's a map from functions to R. And therefore, I can write things which sound a bit strange if you think of them just as vectors. I can, for example, say I apply the map to a function F. And I can, for example, also apply it to the product of 2 functions. So let them fg be real functions, or be, we have already introduced the symbol for that. They are c infinity m, functions on the manifold. And so applying a vector to the product of the function now has, of course, a clear meaning. It means if I look at the path defined by this vector, or a path that corresponds to walking in the direction of this vector, how does the product of f and g change if I walk in this direction? And the lemma now tells us that this can be expressed by how f changes if I walk along the direction x times gp, this is just the function g evaluated at p, plus the function f evaluated at the point p, and p is this point where the tangent space lies, times x applied to the function g, so times how g changes as I walk around along x. This can again be proved and is also proved in the lecture notes. As I said, I'll be happy to give you the detailed proof in case you find that it's not understandable how it's done in the script. But please look at the proof in the script. It gives some insight in how we work with these objects. So I think if you actually read through the proof and understand the steps of the proof, then I think you have really a good grasp of the definition itself. So I think it's a very good exercise to do that, just to understand the notions I've introduced. Now, TPM is a vector space. And the question is now, if it's a vector space, what's the dimension of this vector space? I mean, almost obviously for a sphere, it's 2. And generally, it's actually true that for a d-dimensional manifold, this tangent space is d. That's not surprising because we said that locally it's corresponding to a Euclidean space. But we can actually do more. We can construct an explicit basis for the tangent space. So we will, what I will now do as a last thing, and I will come back to that after tomorrow, because that's something that we have to really do in very much detail, because everything else will be based on that. We will have to introduce a basis for that that depends on the coordinate that we choose. So a priori, if I have a tangent space, I can of course equip it with any basis, but it's very natural that if I have a manifold like this one and a chart, that I somehow choose the basis of the tangent space at any point in a way that makes it easier to work with this particular representation. So now the idea is the following, and here I will just give you the picture today, and on Thursday I will turn this into a mathematically precise statement. So let's again here look at the manifold. Here is some point P, and let's draw picturally the tangent space. So this is this vector space, so the thing here that is has the linear structure. Now, as I said, a vector in this tangent space can always be generated by considering a curve that passes through P, and the vector will then correspond to somehow, this is now just the intuition, which is of course a correct intuition, but it's not the way it's done mathematically, but the vector X would now be an arrow in that sense. But as I said, we're not talking about arrows in that sense. So formally X is this map. But now if you have a chart representation, okay, I think I always use the color for that. So let me do that here as well. So we have some, let's suppose this whole thing lies in a region which is a chart domain. So we can map it to something, and I will always, of course, for my examples, remain two-dimensional because I cannot very easily draw in a three-dimensional or four-dimensional way. So I have this two-dimensional example. I can have the representation of this curve. But now it would be nice if the curve, so if I want to define a basis vector here, I could choose an arbitrary curve, because I a priori can choose the basis in an arbitrary way. And why shouldn't I choose a curve which has a particularly nice peak representation in this chart? So what I could do is to say, let's consider a curve which in the chart just looks like a straight line up. So in other words, in the chart, it's only the x0 component that changes. So this is the chart representation of the curve gamma. So this is gamma on the left, and this is the chart representation. And the chart representation is the following. It's taking some lambda and mapping it to x gamma. And I demand that this is just gamma, in this case, 0. So that's what this curve is. It's just, sorry, not gamma, lambda, 0. And of course, I could also put the point here. So I could choose this point. It doesn't need to be here. That was an assumption we made previously. This point can lie anywhere I like. Let's say here, this would be the chart representation of the point. And this is now, so a vector that corresponds to a path that has this nice form. And of course, I can make this also in the other direction. I can also say there is another nice path. Let me choose another nice color for it. Okay, let's take this yellow one. It's not very visible, but I hope you see it nevertheless. So that's another thing. This would define another vector. And if I, okay, in this two-dimensional case, I only have two options doing it in this direction or this. This gives two vectors here. And what you will see is that these vectors form a basis of this tangent space here. So I just construct them in that way. And these vectors will have names. And these names are usually creating a lot of confusion. So I nevertheless put the names here. So this red vector will be called d to the dx0. It looks like a derivative, but it's just a name. Don't decompose these symbols. Just look at it as a name. Of course, there's a reason why we call it like that. And this yellow vector would be called d to the dx1p. Just take it as arbitrary names, which you will justify next time. Okay, so I think I'll stop here. Let me just finish by saying that I've now given you an intuitive idea of how we will define a basis. Next time, I will make it mathematically precise what these basis elements are. And then we are in a position to introduce all these objects. Now we have a vector structure. And remember that the whole tensor structure, I was at the beginning of the lecture telling you everything we are interested in, like the curvature and so on, will be tensors. So these tensors will all live on the space we defined here. So that's why this tangent space is so important. All the objects relativity talks about, for example, the Einstein field equations talk about, will be objects in this space at any point P. Of course, any point P has a tangent space, and at any point P, we will have such a tensor. So it's a tensor field. So that's where we'll go to. And that's kind of an outlook. And now we are in the middle of preparing ourselves for that. Okay, that's all for today. I wish you a nice evening, and I hope to see you again on Thursday.